Hello and welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After, a picture ebook. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will meet survivors of the Asian tsunami and read about their narrative of a chilling first-person account of their near-death experience, unfortunately. Today, I will read out part 2 of chapter 9 and it concludes only next week. In the process, we will see some amazing pictures from spectacular locales. But let us first recap what we have seen, what we have learned in the previous book reading sessions before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Livelihoods based on local agro-meteorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of local agro-meteorological conditions prevalent in an area. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous tribal women, solid waste management, universal health care access, sustainable developmental goals. They are all factors to be included in the developmental agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in reporting disaster preparedness or the lack of it at district level. Disaster is the impact of a calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock, and landscape. Let me run a slideshow of natural calamities across South Asia. Indeed, no part of the world is safe from natural or man-made calamities. There is also a small sideshow or slideshow of survivors. But now let me start reading about the survivors of the Asian tsunami. Shankar, a fisherman and resident of Kachal in Nankauri group of islands in India's Andaman Nicobar Islands, felt the mega earthquake and decided to go with his brother to save their fishing boat tied to the anchor at the bay. As they entered the bay, they saw giant foamy, frothy waves heading towards them from a distance between two shores seen in the picture, but we did not think much of it. They managed to untie the boat from the pier and started pushing it towards the jetty for a firmer entrenchment. By then, the wave engulfed them. All boats in the jetty were let loose and the boats were tossed around. The first wave hit the hilly terrain and receded, bringing in its wake debris from civilization. We ourselves were tossing in the tumultuous waters, battling for breath and life. I think after a few waves lashed and receded, me and my brother limped back towards our home. Only then did we think of looking up towards our home and family. The house was no longer where it used to be. In fact, it was destroyed. As we came homeward, we realized this. We felt miserable that we had gone to save our boats instead of our family members. But then someone from my family called out. By God's grace, all my family members were safe. They had run uphill as the waves came. After that, it was nearly well past lunchtime. Must have been sometime late in the afternoon. Like everyone else that day, we too were shocked. And we stayed up all night uphill in the thick jungles. Next day morning, my brother and I decided to do something to help the situation. We went up with one boat to the Champion Island to look for survivors. There we first anchored the boat, walked uphill, started walking looking for survivors. We were at the top of the hill when suddenly we felt flashes on our faces. Looking down, we saw many marooned people who had collected shining debris and were trying to catch our attention by reflecting sunlight on our faces. They were wading desperately from an inundated pool of water. Sea water had risen and inundated places where they were caught unawares. My brother and I confabulated and decided that we cannot show our boat to them at this point. We went down on foot and calmed them, told them what has happened and that they will bring the situation to the notice of the authorities. Come back with a search and rescue team and gear and do their best to get them all out alive. We pleaded for a little time because we felt that if we showed them our surviving modest wooden boat, they would all desperately try to get in to save their lives and not only will the boat break up, but more might die out of drowning. So after convincing them that we will come back soonest to rescue them, me and my brother came back to Kamortha and reported to the coast guard, who were completely overwhelmed and were very busy. We told them that we are fishermen, we know the location where they are stranded, and that we wanted to rescue them, for which we need some aid and from the administration. I think the officials from the AC's office at that point instructed the coast guard to give us a trawler boat and go and rescue the marooned people. So we took the trawler and went to the place where the people were there. We were also given food packets and water for the marooned people. We went there, gave them food and water, and made 2 to 3 trips to bring them all back. But the administration chose not to reward either me or my brother, but that's a different story, says Shankar with a very wry smile. Dr. Tiupu Alves Yaharin, PhD, Chief of the Tsunami Disaster and Mitigation Research Center at the Graduate Studies Program in Disaster Sciences, Siya Kuala University, Banda Aceh. Yes, of course, it was the largest earthquake I felt ever in my life. I guess most people would feel the same. It was terrifying in a way. People could barely stand and most people were falling because the earth was shaking so hard. Well, I was still living in the US at that time and had just come home for my sister's wedding. We were getting ready to go to the groom's family's house on the other side of the town for the second wedding ceremony when the earthquake struck, and minutes later, the worst natural disaster of the century occurred. Suddenly, we felt very strong shaking of the earth. All members of the family and relatives got out of the house. It was one of the biggest earthquakes we had ever felt in Sumatra. Though we are very used to earthquakes, we felt it would be safer outside till the shaking subsided. Well, I had no idea what was coming at that point. The quake produced a loud thumping sound similar to that of metals colliding to each other with somewhat vertical shake of the earth. It was as if the earth was crumbling down. The thumping sound was almost vertical. The shaking was vertical. Shaking instead of horizontal shaking or swinging. It was like the earth was jumping. It produced some very loud thumping sounds as if metals were colliding. It was a sharp sound. It was like a mass of colliding iron metal bars. We were spontaneously rushing out of the house to the front yard and gathered there. I was actually going back inside the house to make sure that no one was left there and injured inside, when I noticed a large cupboard near the kitchen area was shaking vigorously and was about to fall. I grabbed one corner of it and pushed it hard against the wall so it stayed in place. Later, I realized that that was a very pretty bad idea and that I could have been seriously injured. A few seconds after the earthquake stopped, I rushed outside to the front yard again to check if everyone was okay. I stood there with my family members for about half an hour. Then I went inside the house again, and within a few minutes, I heard a roaring sound coming from behind the house and immediately thought that that could be water, which had almost certainly immediately turned out to be the devastating tsunami. I did not notice any crack on the soil surface around me following the earthquake, and most buildings seemed to be in place in our neighborhood, although some physical damages would have been expected, I suppose. Most buildings were damaged by the tsunami, and so was my house. Although the tsunami wave was not that forceful around our home, as it approached the farthest distance inland, the water did reach 2.5 meters in height. The waves also brought tons and tons of debris from the coastal areas, causing damages to buildings and structures on its path and making access into it and out of the residential and public areas extremely difficult. The corrosive nature of the tsunami mud did cause serious damage to our house, as it did to thousands of others. At that point, the house was submerged for a minute or two, but it did recede quickly. Some part of the house is made of wood, so within a few minutes, it was revealed that the wooden parts were totally damaged. The concrete part of the house was also flooded for up to 2 meters. It took a couple of years to rebuild. Like everyone else in the village, we had to relocate to a relative's house at a distance of 15 kilometers. It was far away from our house. My grandmother was drowned and found herself unconscious. We stayed in my relative's house for a week. I had heard of a tsunami, but did not know that an earthquake would trigger it. As I said before, in my subconscious mind, I had thought that the roaring sound approaching the back of my house could be water. But the word tsunami had not crossed my mind at that point. Nevertheless, that scary sound prompted me to rush outside again, calling on everyone to run because I was sure the water would reach us. Sure enough, less than 2 minutes later, the tsunami was ravaged our neighborhood, which is about 4 kilometers from the coast of Banda Aceh. When the first wave came, I was able to run to safety. I stood in the same place until after the third wave came and after the water receded to about knee high. I think I was not that scared after the earthquake, although I was very concerned that a lot of people would be injured or killed. But when the tsunami came, for a split second, I thought that was the end of the world. When I noticed the water was rising to my knee level, I was able to pull myself up to safety to the second floor, which was about 4 meters high, of a newly constructed neighbor's house by miraculously clinging to what appeared to be a reachable concrete reinforced steel. Please note that while pulling myself up, I had an elderly neighbor who clung to one of my legs and I was able to save him to the same floor too. From the second floor, I was able to look around while the water kept rising and a few villagers were screaming, searching for their family members, and then it fell silent. For me, it was an eerie feeling. At that point, I felt helpless but hoped that God Almighty would save all of us. I was standing on the second floor of the neighbor's house waiting for about 20 minutes, waiting for the water to recede. Then I came down again to check on my family. The short road to my family's residence was covered by tons of the debris and dead bodies were floating all over. My grandmother was unconscious and an extended family member had died after having drowned. I had to evacuate my grandmother and take her to the community health clinic for immediate treatment. The evacuation process was extremely difficult due to the massive debris blocking the streets, and getting a help in this chaotic aftermath would be a miracle. A miracle there was. Well, I think at that point we were just thinking of how to get ourselves to a safe place. There was dangerous debris like pieces of concrete walls, metal roofs, uprooted trees, steel bars, ravaged vehicles, broken glass, nails, barbed wires, you name it, all of it was around. Slowly we were able to reach the main street. From there we had to walk about a kilometer before an extended family member who was unaffected by the disaster found us and took us to a safer place. No one was talking, as if we were in disbelief witnessing just what had happened. There were 3 tsunami waves that struck that day, followed by a series of aftershocks. For the next 6 days or so, we had a few minor earthquakes and aftershocks at least a couple of times every day, so we still had to be cautious. Any faithful Muslim would look at this mega disaster as a test of one's faith. The villages around the area where we lived had become deserted. The survivors from the disaster impacted areas were evacuated to temporary shelters or they opted to join their relatives who were unaffected by the calamity. And there was not much left. I did not see the withdrawal of the sea myself because I was not in the beach area at the time. I would not be able to tell the actual wave height because I was not in the coastal area when the tsunami hit. But other survivors confirmed that the second wave was the largest and the most forceful of the 3. The water did reach 2.5 meters in height at our home when the wave dissipated. There was an approaching train-like sound I heard from the first wave. Indescribable. It was as if it's doomsday. There was nothing except remnants of destroyed buildings and structures and a few trees left. At least half of Banda Aceh municipality had been destroyed by the tsunami. My house is located about 4 kilometers from the coastline, but pretty much everything in between was destroyed. There were debris and remnants of buildings everywhere. In most cases, nobody could tell where their house used to be exactly located, as fences were gone too. It was easy to lose one's orientation at that point because the whole landscape had changed. You can see there the mayhem that it wrought. It was something like an atomic bomb had been dropped. There were tons and tons of debris scattered all over. Banda Aceh city alone lost about 80,000 of its residents. The loss of human resources due to the tsunami in Aceh was very significant. They include teachers, professors, students, skilled laborers, farmers, community leaders, employees and corporate managers and executives. The Siak Kuala University alone lost well over 1,000 students, 110 professors and lecturers, and tens of administrative employees. Highly educated human resources were lost. I mean, you think of what it takes to train people to become lecturers and professors. Although a lot of students and faculty members were lost in the tsunami at their home or elsewhere, the physical damage to the Siak Kuala University campus was ironically minimal. Lal Mohan Barek was and still works as a caretaker in the inspection bungalow of the Andaman Public Works Department at Campbell Bay in Great Nicobar Island. Mohan's daily routine included overseeing the supplies, looking after the flowering plants, maintenance of the rooms in the guest house, and catering to the guests. Mohan, as he is called, reported for duty at 6 a.m. and the night shift staff had just completed the formalities of handing over charge to the day shift staff. Mohan's narrative of first-person account and experience of the mega earthquake is so engrossing that I, as an author, should not intervene in his narrative at all. He's a great storyteller, captivating listeners with his peroration and his skills of storytelling. And he relives the moment lets you go with him. He pouts, desperately trying to cup the juices of the betel leaf from flowing off the sides of his lips when he's narrating. It only adds spice to his narrative. So here is his first-person account. I had just reported for duty at 6 a.m., madam, and was taking note of the day's requirements. One water maintenance staff had gone to check the water level in the overhead tank. It was a little past 6 a.m., I think, when I felt a severe jolt. I was frightened because of the severity. The night shift boy was standing still with his hands tied together in front of him and leaning back against the pillar in the corridor. Yet he seemed to be moving horizontally, as if he were sliding on rolling skates. I freaked out looking at him. I saw that the glass panes in the windows were moving horizontally from their bases. He thought it was some devil has besieged his colleague. It was scary, believe me. He screamed that it was an earthquake. The trees in the backyard hillock were prostrating forward at a 90 degrees angle. The staffer at the water tank was finding it difficult to crawl back to the ground floor. He was clinging to dear life by crawling on his haunches on the terrace parapet. It was a fierce earthquake, madam. I had never felt before such a powerful earthquake. It seemed to pause and then again there were vertical movements. It was like the earth was jumping vertically. I heard loud metallic sounds from the ground below. The vertical shifting was fierce. The earth was quaking vertically. It seemed as if some energy was being released vertically. The earth seemed to be dancing one vertical step at a time, but in fierce succession. By then, all guests in the inspection bungalow realized that it was an earthquake and came out to the open driveway. The water from the overhead tank fell out because of the tumult. It was frightening to all of us in the inspection bungalow. By then, the earthquake stopped and we all ran out of the building, started gathering our wits, marveling at the severe jolt. I thought this is the price God extracts from us because we humans have sinned so much that the earth will perish. Suddenly, I heard the roar of a train. Seawater started inundating the low-lying areas. Seawater was roaring into land ferociously. I saw seawater coming in slowly in a wave at first. It seemed to be tied up in round loops, tugging the energy from Mother Earth in tight round knots, lunging towards land. It also withdrew at the same pace. The sea withdrew very far out. Thereafter, the second wave came furiously at super-fast speeds. When the second wave came, it took a toll of humans. I think all the people who died in Campbell Bay died in the second wave that day. The topography changed instantly because the sea invaded dry land. Plantations, human settlements were all invaded. I heard people screaming from the valley below, screaming for help, trying desperately to salvage their possessions. A whole residential colony called the Balu Basti had disappeared under the sea in that bay that you see opposite the guest house in the valley below. I ran downhill to save people, wanted to check on the fate of my family housed about a kilometer away. I saw seawater flooding land in super fast loops. It seemed that water was bound in fierce energy. That is why it was churning in loops as it headed towards land. What speed the water came in at. Phew. I was never before so frightened. I thought the earth was sinking under the ocean, for I had never heard about the concept of a tsunami. I did not know that an earthquake at sea creates such a seismic wave called tsunami. Hell, I did not know that the earthquake's epicenter was on the sea floor. I was terrified. It seemed to herald the end of the earth. People were running pell-mell towards the hills. After about 11 a.m., the sea calmed down, or so it seemed at least. All hell had broken loose. I went on my cycle very nervously and apprehensively to check on the fate of my family. I was very nervous about seeing the mayhem at home. What if my family had died? I went home, located on a hill close by, and was very, very, very relieved to see that my parents and my wife, my sister's children, were all safe. My brother lives in Katchal, and we were hearing stories that Katchal had drowned in the sea. It was a very anxious 3 days before we heard from my brother. All communication links had snapped, so we did not know. We did not know the fate of either my brother or his family in Katchal or of my sister's family in Port Blair. I asked mother what we can do about the food if all our groceries were intact. She told me that there is a pack of rice and bananas, if not anything else. With this much relief mentally, I took off on my cycle again, hoping to go to the port where ships normally bring supplies to the islands. I mean, the ships are our lifeline. I do not know what made me presume that a ship will be there to provide us groceries and rations. Just so used to going to the jetty to offload supplies, I suppose. I went to the jetty only to see that the pyre was not there anymore. There was just no trace of it, you know, to even indicate that there used to be a jetty there. The pyre was just not there. The whole day there was no order or administration. The administration too was overwhelmed and challenged. I fortunately had a home to go back to. Those who lost their homes were staying in relief shelters. Those whose homes were intact stayed in their own homes, like me. We got help from the administration to get relief supplies, but my job was intact, so I did not have to either go to a relief center nor avail of monetary subsidies to rebuild my life economically. However, the one long-term impact has been anxiety. This is a seismically active area and we experience earthquakes often. But every time we experience earthquakes, we first think of a tsunami and become tensed up about what comes next. Mr. K. Chandrasekhar, caretaker of the APWD inspection bungalow in Kar Nicobar. Now I speak to him. This is the district headquarters. It's called Kar Nic. Since it was a Sunday, I was still in bed. My wife was already up and about, going about her domestic chores. I felt a sudden severe jolt from under the bed. Startled, I woke up. I opened my eyes and looked around. No one else was there in the room. The walls and the furniture were there where they used to normally be. That is the first thing we notice in this earthquake-prone area, as we are used to earthquakes often, madam. So I fell asleep again. Then in a couple of seconds, it seemed that the bed I was sleeping on moved horizontally as if sliding. I was startled again and bolted upright. I saw the window glasses vibrating and knew that it was an earthquake. The earth seemed to be roaring violently. I kept feeling jolts and thuds. It went on for an unusually long time. Within minutes, I sensed a deafening roar. The APWD inspection bungalow was on the seashore, barely a few hundred meters from the sea. I heard a deafening roar. It was as loud as the Air Force transport aircraft landing at the nearby Air Force base. I looked towards the source of the sound and saw that the sound seemed to be originating from the sea. Even now, when I hear the transport aircraft land, I shiver in panic. The froth from the sea waves was making the noise. At that point, the froth was marching menacingly towards land. It seemed very strange for such frothy waves to make such a terrifying noise. Being used to seeing the shoreline at a distance, I was even more perplexed to see that the seawater level suddenly was as high as the coconut palm trees. The wave was still at a distance from the beach, so I ran home, wore something that I could grab because I knew instinctively that something has gone terribly wrong, called out to my wife and children to run for safety and ran inland. By then, I think the first wave struck the coast. Tremors followed. It seemed as if the earth was being hammered by metal rods from below the ground. Such was the noise that was emanating. By then, I think I was in the center of the island. I sat there to catch my breath. I felt another very sharp jolt from underneath. Actually, madam, it felt like I was lifted up in levitation and I was dropped. Mother Earth was very, very angry. The waves kept coming. Every time they withdrew, there was lots of debris. Another caretaker of the inspection bungalow lost his wife and children to the tsunami. Poor guy. The sea waves were menacing all morning that day, one after another. For 3 days thereafter, the earth kept heaving violently in aftershocks. The next day, though, there was no further tsunami. It was terrifying to see the sea level rise so high and invade land so menacingly. Kim Hughes. son of Sitaram in Campbell Bay, Great Nicobar Island, was 24 when the tsunami struck his village at 41st kilometer settlement in Campbell Bay in 2004. Says he, when the earthquake struck, I had just woken up and was just tottering for my ablutions, still sleepy. I fell down because I lost my balance. Me and my father gathered our wits and called out to all our family members to come out of our dwelling because this was a massive earthquake. Definitely. Barely 10 minutes later, the sea invaded the island, taking all our frugal belongings from our home. The wave came back higher and stronger, and instinctively we started heading inland for our safety. Fortunately, Campbell Bay is full of hills, so it was easy for us to reach the higher echelons of the hills in relatively short span of time. We were safe from the marauding waves only because we were on top of the hills. The waves were as high as that casuarina tree cluster that you see there. There were more than 7 ferocious waves that day. Each time the sea withdrew after invading land, our pigs ran inland screaming towards the jungle. So did the goats, but the goats have kind of escaped and become feral. They no longer respond to our calls or come back home. Okay, so now that is all for tonight. Survivor's tales will continue next week. I hope you found today's survivor's tales interesting. There are a lot more of stories of survivors coming up in the next episode. Please do subscribe to our channel and share the videos in your circles and networks, because we need your support and encouragement to start a web series on disaster risk reduction. Please don't forget to tune in to the live interaction around 7:30 p.m. Saturday, 17th July 2021. I hope to catch you during the live interaction. Until then, take care, keep smiling, stay safe, and stay home. Ciao!